Good morning. Mainit konti ano. Pero paliwanag lang. This is not a place to prepare you for the hot place that you know. But rather, it is a warning not to go there. This trip, we were able to visit Curon, you know, and enjoy the beauty of the country. Habang na doon kami, mayroon kaming bangkiro at saka tour guide. The tour guide was a Katutubo, and he was telling us some amazing stories about how the missionaries started work in Curon, at kung paano that the Katutubo translators, who did not know how to speak English, had to learn to translate them. So that was a very difficult job. I only knew one thing that happened in Mongolia, that was the same thing. But this lady started translating the missionary. She did not know anything about English. She had not been to school. But in 2 years' time, she spoke fluent English by just reading the Bible. Okay. Anyway, itong guy na ito, talagang masyadong bibo, talagang very funny. Look at some of the translations. Sabi niya, one time the missionary was preaching, repent before you enter the kingdom of God. So sabi niya, paano ko i-translate itong repent na ito? So nakita niya isang member, may makeup. Sabi niya, alam ko na. Sabi niya, magpapintura kayo bago kayo makapunta sa langit. Kasi repent, eh, di repaint, di ba? Maganda, no? Sabi niya, if you don't repent, the wrath of God will be with you. Wrath of God. Kung hindi kayo magpapintura, ang daga ng Diyos ay kakainin kayo. So, very nice translation, ano ha? One time nakita yung missionary in my bag, bukas, malalaglag na yung computer. Ang sabi niya sa missionary, paano ko i-translate to na bukas, baka malaglag yung computer? So sabi niya, sir, your bag is tomorrow. Kasi bukas eh. Hindi, tomorrow. Translation niya, your bag is tomorrow. Bukas ang bag mo. But the good thing about that, despite the problem of translation, churches were established in Curon. And we praise God for that. You have heard already our prayer request, so I won't repeat that, but we will be leaving for Cambodia on Monday and we'll be back on Friday. And we are doing a training program for leaders. About 9 years ago, we started a national church growth program. And at the time, of the 13,000 villages in Cambodia, they only had churches in 2,000 of them. So the goal was to plant a church in every village, except that at that time, some of the villages were inaccessible because of landmines. Now the UN had already cleared that, and so they have access to the different barangays, so to speak, right now. And across the years, they had planted hundreds of churches already. So they invited me to recast the vision and to evaluate the program, and would appreciate your prayers for that as well. Talking about prayer requests, you have heard about a man who found a bottle by the sea. Very familiar story about genies. And the genie told him, you have 3 wishes. Number one, he said, can you give me $100 million? No problem. $100 million in a box. Can you give me a very expensive sports car? No problem. There was a sports car. Now your third request. Can you make me attractive to the women? Presto, there was a box of chocolate. Are chocolate attractive to women? You don't believe me? Well, one time, you know, it's good to see Nonoy Nito and Inday Luz. We had something in common with Nonoy Nito, we have white hairs already. But that's better than less hair, no? So, at least white hair pa rin yan. And in this particular case, we were talking about issues of how we can really translate the gospel in the many, many cultures that we are in. And this morning I'd like to talk about something personal in my own journey and that of my wife. If you have your Bibles with you, turn to the book of Matthew, chapter 23 to 27. We're talking about Jesus calming the storm. I'd go to City Conceptions also. I met with them last week. And we hope all things are well with them as well. The coming of the storm in Matthew chapter 8 is recorded in Mark chapter 4 and Luke chapter 8. So the Synoptic Gospels have this narrative. There are certain differences in the three stories. In the book of Matthew chapter 8, it was introduced by miracles and the cost of discipleship. If you take a look at the book of Mark, it was introduced by parables. In the book of Luke, it was introduced by family relationships, who are my brothers and sisters, but those who believe in me. The different narratives have some variances, but the main story are the same. Jesus, with his disciples, entered the boat. There was a storm. They were in danger. Jesus rebuked the storm. There was peace again. And then Jesus rebuked the disciples. And then they were able to reach the other shore. That's basically the story. So out of that, we'll take a look at how we can find lessons for our lives today. The first lesson we learn is that following Jesus can result in storms in your life. Now, how we wish that Christians can be exempted from the problems and the storms of life. But the Bible reminds us that temptation is very common to all men and women. As a matter of fact, may I suggest to you that the moment you become a Christian, then storms begin to appear in your life in one form or another. For example, before you became a Christian, hardly do you have any law that governed your life. Moral law was not so much of importance to you. You can do whatever you want. Because we are simply told that if you don't believe in God, then there is no truth. If there is no truth, there is no law. There is no law, you don't have guilt. And if you have no guilt, you have no conscience. You have no conscience, then you have no shame. Everything else is permissible. But the moment you believe in God, then all of a sudden, the laws of God applies to you. And so when you take a look at the moral law and the Ten Commandments itself, then the don'ts all of a sudden appear, especially in the second tablet of the Great Commandments. So eventually, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that. Now, before, it's all right for you to look at beautiful women any way you want and maybe count numbers. But all of a sudden, even looking at a beautiful woman, if it is impure, becomes sin already. So storms come into your life. And in that sense, we expect not only internal storms to come to us, but physical storms as well. Now, notice what happened. The Lord Jesus Christ invited his disciples to board a boat to go into the other shores. Well, they will continue their ministry. And perhaps that relates also to the core value of the alliance, right? Lost people matter to God. He wants them found. God is not satisfied with simply one place. He wants to image himself to the ends of the world. In this particular case, to the other end of the shore. Now, when he got inside, most of those disciples of Jesus Christ were seamen. They were fishermen by the Sea of Galilee. Therefore, they knew the signs whether storms would hit them or not. And apparently, it was a nautical dream. The stars probably were twinkling in the night skies, and the sea was calm, and they expected a very smooth voyage. And so the Lord Jesus Christ was with them. He was in the stern of the boat. And interestingly enough, the book of Matthew mentioned there was a caution there, and so Jesus was able to sleep. And while he was sleeping, the disciples were apparently rowing, and then the storm hit them hard. Now, the waves were high, the winds were howling, and the waves were beginning to fill the boat, and it was life-threatening altogether. Now, I know that kind of problem because when I was younger, a few years ago, I was ministering in Davao del Sur. And we reached a particular place called Kayapunga. It's a beautiful place. And their church was called Moonlight Bay Alliance Church. Ganda na, Moonlight Bay Alliance Church. Sabi ko naman, bakit naman Moonlight Bay? Parang nightclub yan sa Manila. Eh, sabi na kasi, nung magpatayo kami ng building namin, yung mga members namin, mga farmers yan. So kung araw, nasa bundok yan. Pagkagabi, pumuputol ng kahoy, dinadala doon sa shore. At hinihintay muna yun na may buwan para makita nilang ginagawa nila. So the church was completed during moonlight nights. Kaya ang tawag sa kanila, Moonlight Bay Alliance Church. No? Kaya lang may mga young people sila na nag-aral sa Manila. Nakita nila yung mga nightclub. Pag-uwi na, palitan natin yung pangalan. So, pinalitan yung pangalan from Moonlight Bay to something na hindi na-associated sa nightclub. But I was traveling around Sarangani Bay kasi yung trabaho ko noon was to ensure that the church lot that were given by the parents to the church will not be taken back by the children once the parents die. Kasi noon, alam mo naman, sa inyo na yan, pastor lugar na yan, mula dyan, sa nyug na yan, hanggang sa kahoy na yan, patayo ng simbahan, sa inyo na yan. Pero wala mga titulo yan, wala mga kasulatan yan. So, pag namatay na yung parents, yung mga anak, binabawi nila. Kaya ginagawa ko ng deed of donations or last will and testament para hindi makuha yung lupa na yun para sa mga simbahan. So, kagagaling na namin sa Sarangani Bay, papauwi na kami sa Glan. Pagdating namin doon, hapon na. Sabi ko sa kaibigan ko, sabi ko, tuloy tayo sa Glan. Sabi niya, Pastor, buka masama panahon. Baka tatamaan tayo. Sabi ko, hindi, okay lang yan, okay lang yan. Manalangin naman tayo. No? So, okay. Eh, dahil kaibigan ko, sumama na kahit na ayaw niya. After about 1 hour na sa pambot kami, bigla na lang we were hit by the storm. Pagkatapos, madilim. And the problem with that is not only na yung shores na yon, mga boulders of stone na pagka bumagsak ka sa shore, sigurado wala kang ligtas doon. Not only that, ang mga floating logs ay nasa dagat din. Pagka tinamaan ng pambot yon, yung pambot na yan, mawawasak yan, malulunod kayo. Eh, sabi ko, pambira itong pag-ibig talaga. Kaya ako nagpupumilit ng gabi yun sapagkat nga ako sa isang dalaga na tatawagan ko siya sa Maynila ng gabi yun. So my love was greater than the storm. You know? So, alam mo, when you are young, matapang ka eh. No? Sa kabulan ng pag-isip, eh, mamamatay pala ako rito. Sana hindi lang ako tumuloy. No? But, ang nag-save sa amin was lightnings. So I was praying for more lightnings. Eh, sino ba naman nagpe-pray for more lightnings? I was praying for more lightnings because when the lightning strike, there are about 10 to 13 seconds na may light sa harap. So makikita kung saan dumadaan yung boat kung may mga log sa harap namin. Masabi ko, right, left, hanggang makarating sa Glan. Alright? So, ganun din nangyari. Storms came very unexpectedly to the disciples. Now, when the storms came, and it was life-threatening, all of a sudden, you begin to ask yourself the question, what do you really believe? Sabi nga nila, the rubbers meet the road already. So when the storms of life comes, how do you survive? How do you deal with that? And it's not only physical danger, no? It can mean emotional as well. Let me tell you another story. In 1998, we were prepared to celebrate our 25th wedding anniversary in Manila. But at the time, I had a board meeting in Chicago. So I was there. I invited my wife to accompany me because the policy of the organization was if I would travel 2 weeks or more than 2 weeks, my wife had to come along to ensure that marriage is intact. So it's expensive, but it's a price you pay to keep your marriage. While we were there, nagpa-examine si Anne sa St. Luke at nakita na may isang area na dapat i-magnify. Alright? So sabi ko doon ka na magkuha ng examination mo para sigurado. So that Saturday, naghanda na kami, I went to Houston where I had to speak to a church. Monday, magkita kami sa O'Hare Airport sa Chicago, then we'll be back. Yung mamalita namin, puno na ng mga gamit about celebrating our 25th wedding anniversary. Saturday pa lang tumawag na siya. Napuna ko sa busis niya, mukhang kakaiba yung tono niya. Sabi ko, something is wrong. Ayaw naman niya sabihin sa akin because he wanted to tell me much later because I was preaching the following day. So sabi ko, pag hindi mo sinabi yan, lalo hindi ako makapag-preach bukas. So sinabi na niya na yung resulta ng biopsy may aggressive cancer siya. So immediately, you ask yourself the question, sa lahat naman ng babae sa daigdig na ito, bakit asawa mo pa may cancer? Di ba? Sabi ng Panginoon Diyos naman, parang impression sa isip ko, eh sinong gusto mo? I-recommenda mo nga. Eh sino naman i-recommenda mo magkaroon ng cancer? Eh pastor ka. Eh di wala ka naman magagawa. You have to accept na lang the reality na, eh asawa mo eh, wala kang magawa doon. Ano? So you have to accept that with peace in your mind that God is in control of the situation. Because when storms come, what do you really believe about God? And that is what's important. And so the operation took place. At nang pa-opera na siya, nag-away pa kaming dalawa. Kahit na Kristiyano kayo, nag-away din kayo pa minsan-minsan, ano ha? Kung hindi ko nag-away, raise your hand. Ah, wala. So, nag-away din kayo pa minsan-minsan, ano ha? Okay. Ang pinag-away namin, saan siya magpa-opera? Sa Chicago o sa Houston? Eh, sabi niya, sa Chicago na lang, sapagkat may confidence sa surgeon doon, Kristiyano. Eh, wala kang magawa because it is her body system that needs to respond. So I said, okay, we'll honor your decision. So the day of the operation, the surgeon prayed a simple prayer. Sabi niya, Lord, use me as an instrument of healing Anabelia. That's it. And then after 2 days, pinalabas na siya. All right. So sabi nila, 10 years. But today she survived cancer for 18 years and she is already free of cancer. So we praise the Lord for that, hindi ba? So storms become opportunity for God's revelation that He is the healer. Now, you can know that intellectually, but until you experience it, those intellectualism, in many ways, does not grab you as strong as when you pass through the storm yourself. No? So that's true with us. No? We have storms, breakdowns in relationship, divorces, sakit, bankruptcy, and all that. But storms come into our life, as in the case of the early disciples. So the next question that we have to ask would be, what preparations are we to make for the storms that surely will come? Alam kasi kung may mga bagyo sa Houston, Texas, and Texas is the pathway of typhoons and tornadoes, pagka may storm signal na yan, the government issues warnings already on how to prepare to meet the storm. So alam na nila, evacuation must take place, you must be having shelters and so on and so forth. The same with Christians. What are our spiritual preparations when the storms of our lives would come? Number one, make your last will and testament. No? Eh, baka may mangyari nga. No? Hindi naman lang sinasabi na mangyari, pero baka may mangyari lang. And be sure na naka-order na yung mga lahat ng yun. Sapagkat pagka wala kang last will and testament, baka may mangyari, umiiyak yung misis mo, mabigla siya, may isa pa rin umiiyak sa tabi niya. No? So, kailangan maliwanag yun. Okay, ba? So, the other side of that is this. The biblical convictions that Christians do have will come to the fore whether what you believe is how you will act during the times of the storm. All right? In other words, do you behave what you believe during times of the storm? Because if you don't behave what you believe, there is a disconnection somewhere, and things are not right. So let me suggest to you some simple ones. The first of that is this. When storms come to your life, remember this, Jesus cares. Now, the question may be raised, I know God loves me, but does He care? So the two are of the same shade, but different in terms of their actual meaning. Yes, I love you. But do I care enough to do something about my love for you? Right? So in many ways you can say that if you truly love, you initiate something. But caring is actually the more practical side of it. God loves me, but does He really care? Now, the men, particularly in the narrative of Mark, the question of the disciples, Lord Jesus, don't you care that we are perishing? The other narrative, Matthew and Luke, they don't have the word, do you care? But they were simply, Lord, we are perishing. Statement of fact. But the other side was adding a little bit of meaning to it and almost like a kind of reprimand saying that, Lord, we give everything up for you. And all of a sudden now we are dying and you are sleeping. Don't you care? And you cannot help but feel that way at times in your situation. So the thing that we have to understand is that even if we are hurting, even if we feel that Jesus is silent, that he cares. You see, the thing about it is this. Jesus may be sleeping or silent, but he is not absent. He is with you and in our lives as well. That is why Frank Graff, for example, wrote a very beautiful song. And I remember this, that these were the songs of the older generations when I was a young people or a member of the young people in General Santos City. You remember that song, "Oh yes, he cares, I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief when the days are weary and the long nights dreary. I know my Savior cares." And the one thing we know is that Jesus cares so much that he was willing to die on the cross for you and for me. That is not only love, but that is love with care and compassion. He acted out his love for us. And so today he is risen and he is alive, and he will certainly bring comfort and deliver us. As a matter of fact, when you look at the cross, that is your vision of hope, that the God of the universe loves and cares for you. The other thing about preparation is this. Jesus is not surprised that you are going through the storm. You think he's surprised? You think he does not know you're undergoing pain and suffering? Of course he knows, in verse 39. When he woke up, he did not panic, did he? He did not say, "When did this happen? Why didn't you tell me earlier? I could have done something about it." But one of the things that we ask ourselves the question is this. When you look at the text, there is such a thing in interpretation as the hermeneutics of suspicion. You always suspect the text. Why is it that the disciples were afraid, knowing that Jesus, who had just performed miracles after miracles, why were they still afraid? Now, as John Calvin said, the Bible is silent, so we better shut up. But the point is that you cannot help but ask the question, "Lord, we are in trouble, and there you are asleep. Does it compute?" No, it doesn't. But Jesus simply woke up, and then he said, he spoke to the wind, he rebuked it, and the wind stopped, and there was calmness on the sea again. Now, another thing that we have to answer the question is, in the narratives of the three Gospels, he spoke, he rebuked, he reprimanded the wind. How does that happen? The wind is inanimate, you know? I mean, it's, you don't see the wind, although in one instance in Matthew 14, Peter saw the wind. Have you ever seen the wind? Sometimes you smell the wind, but you can only see the wind in terms of the impact of the wind on an object, like the wind passing through the leaves of the trees. Then you know the wind passed by. Or in the language of John, that you know the spirit passed by because the spirit is the wind, and you can see the blades of grass bending in the direction of the wind. So in this particular case, Jesus rebuked the wind. Now, if you take a look at the whirlwind and look at the book of Job, the whirlwind was a personification of Satan. And therefore, you can even go into two interpretations of the text by simply saying that the role of Satan is to stop the spread of the gospel. The Lord Jesus Christ's disciples were going to preach on the other side of the shore. All right, so that's number one. That seemed to be valid because the work of the devil is to stop the spread of the gospel. But the second part about that is the work of the devil is always around us to discourage us in our Christian life. That's why the Lord Jesus Christ spoke to the wind. Perhaps he was rebuking Satan personified in the wind. So we don't know that. But the other side about that is this. Whether you can view that as satanic or you can view that as natural, the one who created the whole universe can do that as well. He spoke and the universe came into existence. We can spoke against the wind, and there's no doubt about that. It will obey him. Now, he was not surprised. And the theological basis for that is God is omniscient. And his omniscience is permanent. God's attribute is immutable. He does not change. Now, you cannot say that at one time God had a lapse of mind because he didn't know something. No, you cannot say that. Whether he is awake or asleep, God remains omniscient and God himself. He knows everything. Now, you might say that because Jesus was God-man, his omniscience was limited. Well, perhaps you can grant that, but there is no text again that would justify that in a direct sense. Now, on the other hand, I can believe that Jesus is aware of that, but that he would not allow his disciples to pass through the storm, because the storms of life is part of the discipleship curriculum for his disciples, right? It's part of his training program, yeah? Because most of the time we learn about life in terms of our experiences, and Jesus will not exempt them from passing through that class, that curriculum we call the storm. And so his disciples have to pass through that. They have to learn perseverance. They have to learn to build up character. Now, Paul gives that to us in Romans chapter 5, 1 to 6, for example. He said, therefore, because you have been justified by your faith, you now have peace with God. Therefore, by his grace, you have access to God in heaven. And your access to God in heaven will allow you to glory in your suffering. And glory in suffering results in perseverance, steadfastness. And steadfastness produces character, and character produces love. So, in other words, because you are in Christ, you have access to God. You have access to God. You have peace with God. You have good relationship with him. And because you have access to God, then you can glory in your pain. Why? Because you are not hopeless. You have access to God in times of your pain and sorrow. You are never alone. You may be weeping in the middle of the night, but God is with you. You still have access to God. Wherever you are never a cosmic orphan for some reason, because God said, hey, you have access to me in prayer. The same thing was repeated in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 18. Because you are in Christ, you have access to God through Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. So in that sense, therefore, God is not surprised that we pass through the storm. But what he's trying to tell us, but you are not helpless, because you have access to me. And if you have access to me, then in that sense, you have hope. Now, this access concept is perhaps interpreted in the French word entrée better. Years ago, I was active in the Philippines with the Philippine Council of Evangelical Churches. And so we would meet President Aquino almost every 3 months. And every 3 months, we discuss with her whatever we can give counsel to the government, but more important still, we can request any cabinet member to sit down with us to discuss issues from pornography, you name it, and so on and so forth. I was excited one day when the protocol officer said, the president would like to see the evangelical. As you know, in this country, at the time, only the Catholics were recognized. But the evangelicals, now, that was bad political move. But I insisted through my professor at UP noon, sinabi ko sa kanya, ma'am, dapat naman i-remind mo si Presidente that she is the president of all Filipino people, whether Catholic or Protestant or native or what. You cannot just say that you're the president of the Catholic, but you're the president of everybody. And so the president acceded to that, and we were there. Excited na kami, dapagat tumawag na yung protocol officer, sabi niya, Reverend Vencer, will you please text again the spelling of those who will come. Pati spelling, ha? Inaayos pa, pati middle name. Right. Pagkatapos doon, may instruction na, dito ko sa gate na ito magdaan. No? Right. Punta kami doon, nakabarong pa kami lahat. Ano, ha? Yung iba, nakakot pa nga, kahit na mainit, parang sauna yung jacket mo. Pero okay lang, kasi presidente yun. Ano, ha? Pagdating doon, may gwardiya, may listahan siya. Pangalan mo, bigay mo, check. Check. So, nakahinga ka ng ano, maluwag, sapagkat nakalusot ka na. Eh, na? Pagdating sa building, may gwardiya pa rin doon. Pangalan mo, check. Pangalan mo, check. Okay. Pangalawa na yun. Second floor, may gwarda na naman. Pangalan mo, check, check, check. Third floor, may gwarda na naman. Pangalan mo, nainis na ako. Sabi ko, ang buhis ba na binabayad namin sa inyo para lang mag-check ng pangalan namin? Right. So, galit ka na eh, sa election eh. Lapit ng lapit kayo. Ngayong presidente na eh, hindi ka na makalapit. Ano ha? Eh, sa wakas, last floor na, nandun na si Cory, na nawalan yung galit mo. Kasi nasa harap ka na ng presidente, di ba? Parang, wow, importanting tao ako kasi nasa harap na ako ng presidente. Now, magnify that without measure when you are in the presence of the King of Kings. Right? What God is saying is that, hey, come on. You may have problems, and I know that. But the point simply is that you are never without hope because you are in the presence of the Almighty God with whom nothing is impossible. The one who said, whatever you ask in my name, it is done. And so we go there with already the blessings of the Lord that when we pray, God is committed to answer prayer. And therefore, we should have hope. Now, not only is Jesus not surprised, but Jesus will act. Jesus will act. Alam mo, one of the blessings of the pastor is that mababang sweldo mo, maganda naman yung mga perks mo. Di ba? Hindi ko sinasabi mababa sweldo ng pastor nyo, pero sinasabi ko lang na maraming perks sa mga members. Isa sa mga perks, binigyan kami ni Ann ng ticket to watch the concerto entitled Bolero. No? Because they knew I like that. No? I like that song. Musical score. Pagdating namin doon, malapit kami sa stage, you know, nandun yung mga conductor with all those people out there. No? Alam mo yung bolero, maganda yan. All of a sudden, my eyes were roaming around and I told the conductor that the conductor noticed every instrument, hears every note, and nothing escaped his eyes and his attention. Even the littlest instrument out there that can hardly be heard by the naked ear of a human being, the conductor hears that. Fascinating. If a conductor can do that, how much more for God? Nothing happens in your life. Even the drop of a tear that nobody notices, God hears that as well. It is deafening to the ears of God to see one of his children in tears. He will take care of our needs and he will act about it. And that is what is more important. He will act. Now, of course, when he acts, oftentimes we say, well, why the delay? I mean, kawawa naman Panginoon, lahat lang gagawin, kini-question pa, no? Tinutuluan ka na nga, nagreklamo ka pa, delay ng delay pa yung usapan mo, no? But the point is that the concept of delay is a contradiction in terms. Philosophically, you have a problem with the concept of delay when it comes to God because if God is delayed, you have to affirm that God is late. Para magang dito sa Maynila, magpunta ka sa meeting, magtika, delay ako ha. Anong rason? Traffic eh. Lahat naman ang dahilan dito sa Pilipinas, traffic, hindi ba? Delay. Lahat, traffic. Kung election naman, lahat, dinaya. Wala namang natatalo sa election sa Pilipinas, ano ha. Bago ka magkandidato, dinaya ka na. So, may face saving tayo as Pinoy, ano ha. Pero when God, you cannot say, Lord, na-traffic ka ba pagpunta mo rito? You cannot say that to the Lord. In other words, if God is on time, all the time, then he is never late. He may not come 1 minute ahead of schedule, but he will not be 1 second late. Therefore, if he is always on time, the concept of delay does not apply. And you cannot say, well, God is late. God is delayed. No, that does not apply as far as God is concerned. Why? Because we cannot prepare the script how God will act in answer to our need. Neither can you determine the clock in which he will respond accordingly and properly. What we are going to do is wait upon him. Be still and know that he is God. Interesting enough, when he did come, he did say, but you notice the order. In the book of Matthew chapter 8, what did he do? He rebuked the wind first, and then he rebuked the disciples. In the book of Mark, he saved Peter first, or rather, you reverse that. In chapter 8, he rebuked the disciples, where is your faith? And then come the storm. In the book of Mark, Matthew chapter 14, it's the reverse. In other words, he saved Peter first, and then he rebuked him. In management terms, you praise publicly, you rebuke privately. Because yung pag-rebuke ka kay Peter, private na naman yun, parang si Pedro lang nakarinig nun. Pero what is important is this, no? In the case of Matthew chapter 14, for example, Peter was sinking, all right? And then he sunk because he saw the wind. When he saw Jesus Christ alone, he was walking on the water. But when he saw the wind, his eyes away from the Christ, then he started sinking. And then he said, "Save me." Di ba yun ang shortest prayer sa Bible? Nako, kung si Pedro mag-pray pareho natin ngayon, "Oh Lord God of the universe, Lord of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob," nalunod na yung tao, hindi pa nakahingi ng tulong, no ha? Kaya paano sabi siya, maganda yung direktahan na, "Lord, save me!" Direkta, the Lord Jesus Christ, reach out. Now, tingnan nyo yung Greek nuance of that, ano ha? Sinong humahawak? Si Pedro ba? O si Jesus? Kung si Peter humahawak kay Lord Jesus, ang bigat niya, tubig yan, and si Jesus was on the platform of a water, it can be very slippery, basta eh. But it was Jesus who was holding on to Peter. And if God is holding on to you, who can remove you from the hands of God? You are as safe when God comes and acts to deliver you. It is as safe as anything else can be. And then, let's put it this way. Let's also remember that while waiting for Jesus to act, he was present in a boat. He was not away. He was not absent. He was visible to them. Jesus was with them. He never left his disciples. Now, if that is true, then you notice that in Matthew chapter 14, there's a variance there because Mark said that Jesus saw the problem of the disciples. He was praying by a mountainside. Now, that's interesting, therefore, because we are the apple of God's eye, as far as the Old Testament is concerned. Now, that means you are the little maiden of my eye. What does it really mean? It simply means that you are the image in the retina of my eye. Mas malabo, no? Okay. Repeat. Mga lalaki, alam nyo kung in love kayo? Kung in love kayo, sabihin ko na, sa akin na lang na, para mga babae, malaman naman yung katotohanan, ano ha. Nang ma-inlove ako sa misis ko, nagbabasa ko ng low books, pero mukha niya nakikita ko. Yan ang little maiden of my eyes. Ha? You are in the retina of God's eyes all the time. Hindi ka maalis doon. Wherever you are, nakikita ka ng Diyos, sapagkat mahal ka ng Diyos. Nakahiga ka na, nakatingin ka sa ceiling. Mukha pa rin ang girlfriend mo, nakikita mo. Ganyan ang tunay na pagmamahal. Pag mga girls dito, pagka magtanong ka sa boyfriend nyo, "Am I the little maiden of your eyes?" Pagka sinabi niya, "No," two things. He is not in love with you, or number two, he does not know the Bible. Di ba? So, that's it. We are before God all the time. And that is why, if you take a look at Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, God said, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." It is safer to be in the storm with Jesus than to have no storm in your life without Jesus. Let's put it this way. In the case of Peter, the safest place for Peter was outside of the boat because Jesus was there, not inside the boat. And there's another thing that we have to understand. God uses impossible situations to create miracles. To walk on the waters, you must get out of the boat. That's the only way you can walk on the waters. You cannot walk on the water inside the boat. You've got to be outside. But when God is asking you to take the risk, what are your comfort zones right now, which are your boats? It can be your profession, it can be your job, it can be anything in your life. And God is saying, "Hey, I want to use you, I want to do something special for you, but you must get out of the boat of your comfort zone, and trust me completely." Because when you do that, always remember this, no matter how people will perceive it, when you are in the hands of God, you are safe all the time. We need not be afraid. That is why time and time again, when I travel to many places in the world, the one verse that comforts me is Deuteronomy 31, verse 8. And it says this, "The Lord will go before you, the Lord will be with you, do not be afraid." I will remember you. Now, if I may modify that, I would say the Lord will be before you, with you, in you. Do not be afraid. So whatever journeys of life right now you have, whatever storms you are going through, always remember this. The Lord was before you at the cross. He knows your pain and your suffering. But at the same time, He is in you. That is why this through it the church. Always know that the presence of God is with you. But collectively, we can say that the presence of God is with you because when two or three are gathered in my name, there He is in the midst of them. Have you heard about Sequoia of Toyota? Sequoia is the upper end of the SUV of Toyota, comparable to the Navigator, to the Navigators of Ford and all the others. Very expensive car. I always wanted it. But if I have it, my supporters will not give me support anymore. So I decided to use the smaller ones, okay? My point is this. The Sequoia tree is one of the largest, the biggest tree in the world, the tallest tree in the world. It can live for 400 years or more. Now, normally, it can withstand the storm. But the trees that withstand the storm are those that have deeper roots, right? But the Sequoia had narrow roots. So despite the heights and the size, how could it stand the wind and the storms in California? And the reason for that is Sequoia trees are together. And beneath, their roots are intertwined with each other. It's almost like the steel matting when you pour concrete on a road. It strengthens you. That's true with the Sequoia tree. The roots are interconnected beneath the ground. Narrow, but they are together. And the church must be that. The presence of the Lord with you, when you are intertwined deeper and deeper in the word of the Lord, you will be strong. No storm can topple you down. No storm can topple you down. The presence of God in the church will always be one of the greatest comfort. Nobody grows outside of the fellowship of the church. All right? Why? Because it's the body of Christ. Now, granted that churches are not perfect, but still, the church is the body of Christ. And the church is the place where you can grow. Now, notice also the security. In the book of Matthew chapter 8, Jesus said, "Let us go to the other shore." He did not say, "You go to the other shore and God bless you." You know, God, the God we worship is not a deist. In the sense that He created us like a clock, He wound it, and now the unwinding has taken place. It's dying. As if God is saying, "Okay, I've created you, bahala kayo sa buhay niyo." That's not God. As a matter of fact, theologically, God is more intentional in saving us so that we can be with Him for eternity. You notice that? Whenever you debate, God is on the door. Hey, wait a minute. Huwag kang palabas ka na. Balik. He deals with us. He's intentional in the way in which He wanted us to grow in the Christian life. And one of those structures is the local church. When the local church was created by God, it has nothing to do with numbers. The standard of church is not number, but disciples. So discipleship must be the focus of our program. One of the things I like about Jesus Reigns ministry is because we had the joy of having a share in mentoring their leaders for over 10 years now. And they have been growing and growing and growing and growing. Let us go together. So, it's impossible in your mind, philosophically, theologically, practically, you cannot say, kami mamamatay kasama si Jesus. Mamamatay ba ang Diyos? Kasama mo nga eh. So, for as long as God is present, you are secure. And just be very sure you are rightly related with Him because that's where your security is all about. He is present with you wherever you are. Let me give you an illustration. One time I was in Albania, Pauwi na ako sa Athens because we arranged for a reconciliation meeting of leaders in four countries involved in the Kosovo War, and Christians were involved in the war. They took sides and they were killing each other. So we called on the leaders of the churches in Albania, Bulgaria, the Czech Republic, and so on, and Athens. And we met in Athens at the time. And the meeting was about 8 o'clock the following morning, and I had to be there because I was presiding the meeting. That afternoon, on the way to the airport, there was a traffic. My meeting at Nalekame, I arrived about 20 minutes before departure time, and we were told that the counter was closed. All right, so that's standard, no? Hindi na ako papasokin sa pre-departure area. So sabi ko, paano ngayon yan? I have to be in Athens the following day. Yung driver ko was a Muslim young man. Nagipag-away sa kwarta. Ba't naman nyo papasukin yan? Papasukin lang ninyo, kahit nasarado lang, papasukin naman ninyo. Before long, the clerks of the airline started joining the guard and fought against the security guard ng airport, na-intimidate yung guard na pinapasok ako. Sure enough, he was right, sarado na. Wala na magawa. So sabi ko sa mga tao sa airline, can I just stay for a few minutes and pray? No? So I prayed. And then after about 5 minutes, may nakatayo sa akin, alam ko babae, kasi may high heel. No? So sabi niya, Dr. Vencer, can I see your passport and your ticket? Binigay ko sa kanya, 10 minutes. I mean, just wait. After 5 minutes, bumalik, here is your passport, your ticket, and your boarding pass. All right. You have one problem. Yan ang maganda talaga, no? Good news, bad news. No? Good news, may boarding pass ka. Bad news, walang immigration officer. So, ang ganda. So, kung hindi makita yung immigration officer, hindi tataka, hindi ka rin makaalis kahit may boarding pass ka. 5 minutes, so papunta ko sa gate sa harap ng immigration officer, walang tao. Eh, sarado na nga eh. So, hila-hila ko yung bag ko. Sabi ko, am I a fool or what, you know? But ang consolation of Paul said, fools for Christ. Okay, I said, okay, that's me. That's fools for Christ. So I was walking. Ala, sige lang, lakad lang ng lakad. 3 minutes to go, wala pa rin nakikita. Pagdating ko, last hakbang ko, sa harap ng counter, biglang may lumabas. Nakaputi ang uniform niya. Nakita niya ko, what are you doing here? Sabi ko, I'm waiting for you. Pareho kami nabigla. Tinatakan niya, sabi niya, you have 2 minutes to reach your airline. You see, I boarded the flight with 11 seconds left. See, the Lord is never late. He will take care of you. Now, that is about that. Is with God, nothing is impossible. And that's something we have to trust God with. Right? Now, lastly, when you are through the storm, it can either deform you or transform you in your Christian character. The one thing we know is all storms end. But the storm will never leave us. You end one storm, another storm comes. Sometimes, mas malakas. Because you are prepared for the weaker ones already, so pwede ka na sa mas malaki. Kaya, the bigger is your problem, the more mature you are. Sapagkat hindi naman bigyan ka ng Panginoon ng problema na hindi mo kaya. So, pagka malaking problema, praise God, ay nako, mature na pala ako. Pero Lord, huwag naman masyadong malaki. So, do not pretend you are not mature. Kasi, no, when you pass through a storm, another storm comes. And you learn from it, you keep on growing and growing and growing. Why? The reason for that is because God wants to use you to minister to other people as well. The storms of your life is not only designed for you, it's designed to carry out God's purpose in your life. Through you, He can bless other people in the world as well. And the strength of your message, pastors and Christian leaders, is this. The power of your preaching is directly proportional to the experience of your pain. Nobody wants to hear a sermon where the pastor has only a bump on his head. They want to hear a sermon where the pastor na dapa, hindi na makatayo. And then all of a sudden, a miracle took place. That's the one they would like to listen to. That is why the preaching of a pastor must be from pain to pain. We are all wounded healers in another sense. Now, you notice one thing. When Jesus Christ rose from the dead, He showed Himself to the disciples along with Thomas. Look at the marks of the nails on my palm. Now, why is it that in the resurrection, when Jesus already had a glorified body, He still had the marks of the nails? Could it be that he is telling us Jesus continues to be our wounded healer? Only wounded healers are powerful. And that's why storms are important in our lives, in a sense, though we do not pray for it. But when it comes, go through it, because God has a purpose for your life to make you a better one. Some people, when they have storms in their life, they turn their back from God. They become atheists. In Bangkok, a young man came to me and said, "Pastor, I heard your message and I don't believe in God." And I said, "Why don't you believe in God?" "Because of the pains and the evils around me in Cambodia, in Thailand." So I said, "I have three problems. Number one, you said you don't believe in God." "Yes." "Can you define for me the God you don't believe?" And he looked at me. "Well, for sure, you have to know whom you are denying." And the philosophical problem is this: the moment you can define God, he is not God. Because God is beyond predication. You cannot put predicates on God as a human being. You can combine all the wisdoms of the philosophers across the centuries of time, put all the languages together, they still cannot define completely God, because God is transcendent. You cannot define God. The moment you say, "I can define God," then you have become God yourself. And in that sense, the question of contradiction is there, because definition is fundamental to atheism itself. And the second is, assuming that you become an atheist, does it remove the pain and the problem? The evils and the pains are still there, even if you don't believe in God, and the pains and problems are still there. Then the next question is this: who do you talk to when you have pains and problems? If there is no God, there is no transcendence. Because all the others beside you are having the same problem, or even worse than you do. They cannot bring you comfort. The only one who can comfort you is the transcendent God, who is all-wise, all-powerful, the God with whom nothing is impossible. In that sense, therefore, is it a valid option for young people today? You can be transformed. I spoke last night at the Jesus Reigns 30th anniversary, and I mentioned the theologian Lewis Meads. And when he was asked, "How would you define life?" he only said this: "Life is a box. Life is a box." He was talking about the boxes of the calendar. He said, every box of those, every day you fill it up, that box can be your last box. So you write something there, and at the end of the day, what did you write in that box before the Lord? Is your life pleasing to God? Have you done something that influences other people? Have you shared the gospel within that box? And every day that box, you have to write it, because that is your diary as far as God is concerned. And the final box of your life is a coffin. So when the final box is in there, and you are in the box, what do you have left? What legacy have you left behind? Is your life meaningful? That the purpose of life is in it. But if you are a believer, if you are a Christian, once you get into the final box, what if the final box, when they close the lid of the box, it only opens a new door of a new existence, and therefore you celebrate your third birthday in life? For the first birthday certainly was your natural birthday. Your second birthday was when you were born again. And the third birthday is when you enter into the kingdom of God yourself. So when you are in the final box, will you leave behind a legacy that is godly? And then you enter into a new existence. My friends, storms will come in your life. Will it transform you? Frankly, passing through life, I have to admit, that when we go through storms, two things battle within me: faith and doubt, faith and doubt, faith and doubt. You doubt God when you pray. Have you ever experienced, "Amen," and somehow you feel the deafening silence of God, that nothing has happened? Doubt. And yet faith is the antidote to doubt. Because if you have no faith, that doubt will grow to a point where you become deformed. But doubt challenges our faith that it should grow in the Lord. I'll close with this. We have six grand children, all girls. I have no problem about girls. I'm just asking the question, where are the boys? But the last one is special. And every day, Anne likes to talk to them, but especially to this youngest one. Somehow, when we watch her, she's alone with her own tab, alone in her world. Nobody knows what is in her mind, isolated from the rest of creation, perhaps. She cannot talk. And you cannot help but feel that deep pain and despair in your heart. When you watch the other children, 6 years old, and they are playing, and they are running, jumping, romping around, and they are normal kids. Go to school, socialize with other kids. Parents are dreaming and planning what will the child become. And then you are looking at your own granddaughter, and you don't know. You don't know at all. Doubt. One time my daughter asked me, "Dad, do you still believe in miracles?" How do you answer your daughter that way? You're a pastor. What we can't understand is, why do we love her so much? And all of a sudden it dawned upon me, if I can love my granddaughter like that, God loves her more than I ever can. And God loves each one of us as nobody else can. We have deformities ourselves, but God loves you in a very special way. He taught me patience. So that is how, as a pastor, I have to face the world. That there are individuals out there that may speak, but they are lost. They are alone in their own world. They are isolated. They are marginalized. And they need someone's touch. They need someone's patience and compassion to reach them. She taught me that. She taught me one thing, that God created her in His image. That in Jeremiah 29:11, God has created her with a good plan for her life. I don't know her plan for her life. My logic is simply not able to comprehend the mysteries of the God who said, the things that are secret belongs to me. I don't know the secret. I wish I can have the key to pry into the secrets of God concerning my granddaughter, but I don't. I weep. I'm wounded. I minister around the world, but my own granddaughter, I can hardly touch her or reach her, and I'm wondering whether she can have a memory of her grandfather. But the only thing I know is this: God loves her. God has a plan for her. And one day, in ways I don't understand, a miracle will take place, because God specializes in impossible situations, and only then when He acts and reveals to us something that we have never seen before. And one day she will rise again, and she will talk, and she will open her mind to God. And then you know that storms in many ways are needed to make us grow and love Him more. Let us pray.